prophetic hope. You alone restore our bodies, our hearts and our minds, and our spirits into your healing wholeness. Draw us closer to you by the power of your faithfulness, that all of your people have the chance to be well and live. So I just want to say from the offset that I love this church. I said that to my husband as we were singing and doing the liturgical movement. That was so beautiful. So thank you for being an incredible witness for us today. It was right around seventh grade that I started to get more involved in my youth group at church. Is there anyone here who has either just finished seventh grade or going into seventh grade in the fall? Yes. And all of us have likely been in seventh grade before, right? Well, in seventh grade, I started confirmation classes in my home congregation, St. Stephen Lutheran Church in Williamsburg, Virginia, where I was born and raised. It was such a great place to grow up, but there were far fewer ELCA congregations there than there are here in Michigan. So thankfully, one of the few was in my hometown, and it was located right across the street from the College of William & Mary. So quite naturally, campus ministry was one of the areas that brought us together as campus and community. I remember students from across the street, as we said back then, and we still do that today actually at University Lutheran Church. They helped out with our confirmation classes. I remember them being really good neighbors to us, sharing their faith stories, attending retreats, teaching our Sunday school classes, and taking us out for ice cream. Overall, I remember their presence having such a meaningful impact in my life and my ability to share about my faith as I got older, because they had led me by example. I can say with 100% certainty that the reason I sought out a connection with campus ministry in undergrad is because I knew people who had done the same. I had a personal connection. And in knowing them, I also knew that their lives had been changed for the better by the relationships they had built on faith. So today, I come before you not only as a Lutheran pastor from Michigan State University, go Green, hey, we're all God's family, right? I also come to advocate for campus ministry because my life has been changed for the better by it. And also I come as a witness to the positive influence that ELCA campus ministries have on college and university campuses still to this day. And I'd say, most importantly, I'm here today to say thank you. As a supporting home congregation, whether you realize it or not, each and every one of you are directly connected to the unique and wonderful ways that our students experience the healing presence of Jesus through Christian community on campus, most often right after they leave home. You know, if I had to venture a guess, I'd say with a certain degree of confidence that the youth in your congregation are super important to you. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
And because they're important to each of you, they're also important to me. Because we, friends, are the church together. I've served as campus pastor at University Lutheran Church in East Lansing for almost a year now. It's my second call after relocating to Michigan for my husband's job from Pennsylvania.
Yay.
Last year, where I previously served there in the area of family faith formation. In just 1 year, I have had the complete joy of seeing the benefits of campus ministry at MSU firsthand, especially since I have had the privilege of serving alongside one of your congregation's finest young people, Jenny Ward. Did you recognize her from the video? Jenny Ward is a senior at Michigan State who serves as one of our student leaders in One Community Campus Ministry. As you may already know, she's working and serving in Oregon this summer, and I believe her family is there visiting her this week. But during the academic year, Jenny serves with us at University Lutheran Church as an authentic witness to the quirky, cool, and life-giving presence of Jesus in Christ-centered communities of faith. Knowing Jenny has been such a blessing in my life and the lives of all our students. She's truly a rock star, loved by all, and leader of those who may feel lost. In many ways, actually, I feel at home here in your congregation because this is Jenny's home, and she is such an integral part of our ministry at MSU. So as we continue to build up our relationship here with one another and in our Northwest Lower Michigan Synod, I look forward to the ways that we are able to meet with one another, perhaps even welcome your children into campus ministry at MSU, where our students have coined this phrase, "We are one community and we're open in every way." And so I was thinking about being open. And one of the things I've learned about the history of your congregation so far is that having an open heart and an open mind has characterized your mission and ministry from the very beginning. And your support of young people in ministry is truly incredible. Pastor David shared with me this week that 6 of your youth and 3 adults, including Pastor Marcy, right, are attending the ELCA National Youth Gathering this week and worshiping in this very moment with 30,000 other youth and leaders as we worship here. It's truly amazing. And as I learn more about the community here at St. Luke's, I celebrate who you are, and I give thanks to God for your witness that extends far beyond these walls. Whether any of us like to admit it or not, your kids won't stay home forever. And we all want them to be prepared to stay connected with a community of faith like this one when they go off on their own. That's why our home congregations are so crucial to campus ministry. Because more often than not, the foundation of a young person's faith is built in the family church home. To be real, most of the students who become connected with us in campus ministry at MSU don't come because they didn't make the football team, or because their roommate is a slob, or because they couldn't afford books that semester. That may be part of some of their stories, of why they choose to come out and be with us on our weekly Fridays at 5 gatherings. But more often than not, the young adults who we get to walk with in ministry are the ones who have been seen and heard, understood, and valued in their home congregations first. And so they venture off into higher education, seeking a similar kind of belonging, a place to call home, a community to provide comfort and care for them, and where they can provide that kind of care for their neighbors, too. We are the church together, and we're gathered into one community by a faith in Christ Jesus that unites us. In the Gospel of Mark this morning, we hear 2 very distinct stories that are typically known for the ways that they point to Jesus as healer. But perhaps, dare I say, more importantly this morning, they also point to Jesus as the one who restores people, not only to new life, not only to health, but to their communities, to the relationships that give them life and sustain their life as they know it, through faith. Mark tells us about a father named Jairus, who is a leader in the synagogue, and an unnamed woman who has been hemorrhaging for 12 long years, who is suffering, whose suffering is the same at least in number of years as the time that Jairus' daughter has been alive. Now, the interplay between these two stories is truly remarkable because here we have two very distinctly unhealable people who have tried everything in their earthly power for their health to be restored. Now, it's often Mark's style to insert a story within a story in order to drive the meaning of his point home. And we see that happening here. The story begins with a synagogue leader named Jairus, who was tasked with upholding Jewish authority, the very authority that was jeopardized by the healing power of Jesus. So the fact that Jairus approaches Jesus to heal his daughter at all is truly a miracle in itself. This is Jairus' conversion story. He approaches Jesus out of desperation because funeral preparations had already begun for his daughter. The rest of the community had accepted the fact that his daughter was dead, but Jairus was unwilling. So he goes to Jesus for help. You know, when I picture this text, I see Jairus coming to Jesus in the dead of night in secret, which would be grounds for punishment by religious law. But there's absolutely no way that the parent of a dying child is sleeping anyway. Am I right? So in his own dark night of the soul, Jairus is willing to do whatever it takes to risk it all, his status and his authority, for his beloved child to live. And the same goes for this woman, who's been suffering tremendously for 12 long years. She says, if I but touch his clothes, I'll be made well. To be clear, friends, this woman is as good as dead. Without a family or any means to support herself, having been rejected by the synagogue because she was ritually unclean, her situation was hopeless. She was outcast, marginalized by a society choosing to uphold religious laws over compassion for their neighbor. So in these stories of both Jairus and the hemorrhaging unnamed woman, we have a case of one who has everything to lose, right? And another who's already lost it all. These stories teach us that having faith means taking a certain amount of risk, and that taking that risk involves trust. That even when you feel you've reached the end of the road, even when you have nowhere else to turn, even when your community turns against you, and you feel you have nothing left to lose, when you put your trust in God, it's less about what you lose and more about what you have to gain. In these stories, we learn that a little bit of faith goes a heck of a long way. And even the most unlikely people who put their trust in Jesus have stories of faith to tell about how God provides life in its fullest form, no matter what the rest of the world may seem to think or say. Friends, this is the kind of ministry that unites all of us as campus and congregation. Jesus shows us how truly crucial it is that we are connected in community, and that each of God's children has a place to call home. Because in a community of faith, you're not cut off. You're restored to life again. In a community of faith, you're not left to suffer silently, but you're seen and heard and loved. In a community of faith, it's our mission together to cast out the fear that separates us from the love of God and that unites us as one in Christ without borders. Because, friends, Jesus can't be here today in person to do this work on his own, what does that mean? Well, it means that we're in it together. Together, we are called to be an extension of Christ's healing and restorative power for the sake of the world. This is the mission we share. And together, we're open in every way. Thanks be to God.